us. My name is Nicole Bush, Director of Alumni Career Professional Development. And with me today, of course, is Sarah McAllister, our Associate Director. And Sarah will be handling a lot of the tech, all of the tech issues. So if you're having any troubles, please chat her directly. And she'll be able to help you with that. We're really excited today to have Maureen Breeze with us. She's going to be giving us, she is the founder of Retreat, Reinvent, Recharge. And she will be giving us a program spotlight for our Guided Career and Life Transitions course coming up later this spring. And I'm not gonna spend a lot of time because Maureen has all the right things to say. All I wanna do is let you know that this session is being recorded and you'll be able to see it on YouTube. It'll be posted by the end of the day. And please feel free, we always invite people to introduce yourself in the chat, let us know where you're coming from, maybe why you joined the session today. And you'll also be able to ask questions. If you will send your questions to me, then we can communicate those as we go through the program. So without further ado, Maureen, I am gonna pass it over to you and let you get started. Thank you so much, everyone.
Great, thank you, Nicole. And I am going to share my screen here and we'll get started. Okay, so welcome everyone. It's a treat to be here. I've had the privilege of working with Nicole and Sarah in the past and I see a few familiar names coming through. So in our hour together, I invite you to have a piece of paper and pen or pencil with you. We'll be doing a few exercises that will give you an experience of doing some reflecting around this topic of career and life transition. So to get us started, let's look at this idea of what happens in the wake of change. So even in this last week, I've worked with a woman who has been working 30 years in her industry. She wants to leave, start a new business, wondering, is this the time to do it? And then there is Jonathan who had, kind of a flip in roles, and he had taken on a new job, stepped away because he was dealing with the health crisis and saying, is this the time to go back and where should I be positioning myself? And then there was Julianne who has been a stay-home mom for years and saying, I want to get back to the workforce, but everything is so different now from when I worked. How do I approach this? So if any of these stories sound familiar to you, you might be sitting in this place of a wake of change, of where you might be feeling a little pushed and pulled and questioning, what is my next step? Am I prepared? How do I strategically move through this time? And we're in a place where there are a lot of disruptions in our world right now that might be exacerbating some of the challenges of transition. We know from a very big picture point of view that the rapid change in technology impacts how we go about work. It impacts whether certain jobs are even viable anymore. And we've seen through the research that changing technology is a huge impact on people's choice whether to transition or not. We know today that technology has an average shelf life of 5 years before it becomes irrelevant. So that can be daunting when you're thinking of joining the workforce and you haven't been working for several years. And it's like, how will I even know how to log into some of this technology? So that is a big disruptor. We know COVID has been a huge disruptor. Not only has it disrupted the way people have worked, but it's disrupted the way we think about our lives and the roles we want our careers to have. We know specifically for women, 1 in 3 women have considered stepping back or changing jobs. We also know that COVID has fueled the Great Resignation. A lot of people are quitting more than ever before and saying, okay, I know I need to work, but how can I work differently? How can I show up differently? So some of these things might sound familiar as you're navigating a potential wake and change. One thing I suggest clients do is take time to really ponder what is triggering the transition. We've talked about several external triggers. Maybe it's COVID, maybe your industry's, revamping. Maybe it's a health crisis. Maybe it's a change in, your family responsibilities and caretaking of parents or children. But you might also be triggered by internal things. you know, perhaps you've been in an industry for a while and you've kind of ridden that curve where it's no longer exciting, you're not learning, you're not being inspired, and something inside of you is saying it's time for something different. Or maybe something's happened in your life and you've had maybe a wake-up call saying, oh my gosh, I want to align my values differently with the work I'm doing. But we invite you to take time to examine this trigger because it gives you the opportunity to harness your motivation. Sometimes when we feel like we are being pushed into transition by external forces, it's harder to tap into that internal drive. So if you can spend time thinking about what's in it for me, if I'm successful with this transition, how will I be showing up in my life differently and what will the rewards of that be? So it's important for us at this point though to think about how does transition differ from change? So I'd like to ask you to think about a time in your life where you've made a change, hoping the change would reset everything. Maybe you changed a job and then you got into the new job and at first it was okay, but after 3 or 4 months, the same things that irritated you before were irritating you now. If you've had experiences like that, chances are you are positioned for a deeper level transition as opposed to a simple change. That by rearranging your external circumstances, it's not going to satisfy you in that deeper level. A transition usually involves a shift. Maybe we're listening to different values, different priorities. It might mean shedding an identity. A great example of this is Andrew Luck, the Indianapolis Colts football player, who at the peak of his career at age 29, he left playing professional sports. He had had a series of injuries, and he told himself after, you know, one of his injuries, he said, if this happens again, I'm not going back. I'm not going to go through another rehab process. I'm going to have to really transition into something new. And then he did get hurt again and he left NFL. And so many people were saying, you're at the height of your career. What are you doing? But he had a transition where all of a sudden he was listening to different internal voices, internal callings, different priorities. And it's a good thing for us to think of, you know, when our life no longer works for us, what is it that needs to change and how do we need to transition into this new place? So let's look at what some of the challenges are during transition. Now, I'm engaged in research on this topic primarily from the perspective of women. So I know we have some men joining us and I'll chime in a little bit about what I know to be true about men, but want to let you know that is the perspective I'm coming from research on this topic. And how we gather this research, when we do our courses for women in transition, we offer a 20 question transition inventory. It allows them to look at the different stages and aspects of transition and, you know, have a snapshot of where they are, where are some of the areas that they need to give special attention to, and where are some of the areas that they feel pretty good at. But we collect that information to see overarching trends. And I'll share a few things we found. This, I think, is very, it makes sense. This wasn't surprising. In this inventory, people rank themselves on a scale of 1 to 5. 5 meaning they've got this figured out, they feel great about it. 1, not at all. And we found that women said, you know, the areas where they struggle most with contemplating a career life transition is first, having the criteria to guide their decision making. That was the lowest scoring principle. And I find that's very interesting. And I see this with men and women. Often when we go into a career transition, one of the first things we start doing is we get on LinkedIn or we get on job posting boards and we look and see what's out there. And then we start to say, can we fit ourselves into that? And we use this external criteria to say, I can do this, I can't, this is an opportunity, this is a possibility. Rather than going in a reverse perspective and saying, what criteria is important for me in this next chapter? What are those things I want to make sure I'm saying yes to? What are those things I want to make sure I'm saying no to? What are red flag posts? What are non-negotiable issues? What are negotiable issues? And coming up with clear criteria before you start the transition process. So we found that this was an area that, women said they struggle with, that they didn't have this in place. The second to a well-thought-out transition plan and specific and concrete goals, that's to be expected. That's stepping into the abyss. What is it that we want to do? How do we go about it? The other interesting thing we found from our research, though, is that women reported having high levels of support. This was their highest ranking score, in general, in aggregate. And, women say, yes, I feel very supported. But in our work with them, when we dive into this concept of networking and support, we find that while women often feel very supported in a career transition, they don't necessarily have the strategic networks they need. And what we're learning is that men and women need different types of networks. The research shows that men transition well when they have a very broad and vast network that they can call upon, meet people, and create opportunities for themselves. Women tend to fare best when they have a three-ring type of network. When they have a very tight internal network with one or two or three people who can be thought partners, reflect back information, help them discover hidden norms in certain industries, then they need that medium-level network of colleagues to call upon to help them open doors to create connections. And then they also need that broad, vast network that we find help men so effectively in their career transition. So this is some of the research we're finding that is really important to share with women and with men as they contemplate their next careers. But let's dive into and get personal about what this means for you. So when you think about a career transition, what gets in our way or what gets in your way? And I would love it if a few people would maybe put some things in the chat room. What gets in the way of a career transition? And I've got my chat open. So, how to rework the resume? Thank you. Fear of having to start over. Fear. Yes. And sometimes with fear, we get into that place of, well, what is better than what could be, right? Or what is better than having to step into that abyss? Money, loss of career, procrastination. Yes, that complacency that we can fall into, lengthy recruitments. And a lot of people talk about the hiring process is different now. It's anonymous. I have clients tell me all the time that they put out tons of resumes and never hear back. So sometimes it feels like a black hole. How to translate skills from one industry to another, the fear of the unknown, ageism. Thank you, Angela. We're going to talk a little bit about that today, but that is a definite, important topic and something that impacts people later in their careers. Not knowing what to do next. Exactly. And we don't often have a structure for doing that deep dive thinking. And Kat, I appreciate that comment because I think when we gain clarity of what it is we want to do next, we can put systems into place to execute. But without kind of a facilitated process to think about what it is we really want to create and cultivating that vision, it can be hard. Also, somebody says wanting to do everything. When we have so many choices, that can create an analysis paralysis, response in us. So we have a lot of things that can get in our way, and we want to be mindful of how we work through those. We also want to be mindful of this idea of ageism. And I wish it wasn't real, but it is. And we can talk about this idea of how do you reframe age as an asset. And there are some important things for us to be mindful of when we're positioning ourselves and we're older. A couple things that come to mind right away is a wealth of experience, wisdom, a sense of resiliency that you've lived long enough to have, that you've had to bounce back, and you can bring that resiliency into the workforce. We're also finding out that people's creative problem-solving abilities peak in their mid-50s and 60s. Now, this is different than the creativity of, coming up with the disruptive technology, inventing the Uber app, or these life-altering creative bursts. Those tend to peak when people are in their late 20s. That's why we find mathematicians tend to be at the peak of their career in their late 20s and early 30s. And they think that's because we haven't become so entrenched in how we see the world that we're more likely to be able to disrupt things early on. But the creative thinking that goes into resourceful problem solving, that peaks in our 50s and 60s. And that is a huge asset that we can be bringing to industries, across the spectrum. And something that, we can make our case upon when we are selling ourselves in an interview type of process. But, for now, we do know it's something real. It's something we have to work against, and it's something that we have to very intentionally reframe as we're considering a career transition. So I'd love to take a moment now and ask you, how do you make time to create a new life? So I had a woman in one of our courses say, last weekend I found myself going antique car shopping with my husband all weekend. And she said, he didn't care if I was there, and I cared nothing about antique cars. And why am I spending my time that way instead of spending time thinking about creating this next chapter of my life? And so I'd love for you all to take out a pen and paper and just write for 30 seconds to a minute. How do you make time for creating a new life? So I'm going to pause for a second. And I'd love it if we could come back together. Is that you might have found you are creating some time. You created this hour for yourself, and that's a great first start. You might, when you started writing, find, gosh, I'm not creating enough time. I'm letting other things dictate how I'm spending my time. I'd love to hear, though, what you came up with. If anybody would be willing to unmute yourself and share, some thoughts you had, or put something in the chat if you would be willing to do that. So we have somebody said they set time on their calendar, and that is great. And I would love to comment that I don't see people do that very often. They wait until it's convenient and they're inspired instead of saying, if I put time on my calendar and I sit down every Wednesday morning for an hour, I will find inspiration if I commit to the process. I hear I struggle with making time because I'm scared to make the commitment to change. Absolutely. Absolutely. And that is human nature, I think, to say, I'm not going to give it the time because I don't know what the outcome will be. So I hear that. Yeah. So Aaron writes, having an accountability partner and schedule a weekly call. I think that is fabulous. It is about giving it some structure. Yes, I get inspiration from reading news and research articles and then fall down the rabbit hole researching people's jobs. Love it. It sounds, Megan, that you're curious and you're letting that curiosity fuel you and take you in some interesting directions. So what I would say in response to this question after the webinar, it might be a helpful process for you to reflect on this a little bit and say, what is it that you want to do in terms of time and commitment to explore your transition? And, if you frame it that you're doing an exploration, that's fine for right now. Sometimes we think we have to go 0 to 60 miles an hour right away. And if I'm going to commit to it, that means in 6 weeks, I'm going to have a new job. And it's not like that. It's a process, and it's, you know, you make a small action, you get a small win, you reconnect with yourself in a deeper way. Then you have a new insight, you connect with yourself in a deeper way, and then you have a new insight. So it's a process. You're not going to have to jump off the high dive board right away. Okay. Part of the fear that I think comes in with taking this leap towards making a transition is that we haven't fully assessed the impact it might have. When we make a major transition, there's a ripple effect, and it does impact the people in our lives. You know, if you have a family, it might impact the family dynamic. If you're, you know, it might impact your finances, it might impact your health and well-being. It can impact a lot of things. So we're going to do an exercise right now to help you think very broadly about the impact your transition might have. So I'm hoping everyone can see the screen. If not, I'm going to talk to you about it real quickly. What I'm going to ask you to do is do a quick brainstorm where you look at your health, you look at your career, your family, your daily habits, your living location, your social life, your well-being, your finances, your community, your identity, and then I have a little tag for other because there are it might impact your pets. You know, I had a client yesterday that is looking at a new job and she has a sick dog and she's like, I can't, it's going to impact my dog right now. So all these things play into our lives, right? Take 3 minutes right now and do a broad brainstorm. Thinking about if you were to create your next life chapter and transition, how might it impact these areas of your life? So I'll pause, I'll put myself on mute for 3 minutes and allow you to dive into this. So I'll call us back together. I know it's not a lot of time to do this, but I invite you to continue with this after our webinar. But I'd love to hear if you had any aha moments or made any connections or had insights, or maybe there was an area you're like, oh, I don't love the impact it would have in this area, or this would be a really great impact. You know, would anybody be willing to share what came up for you, either in the chat or you can unmute yourself too.
Well, I can go. My name is Michael Fox. I live in Memphis, Tennessee, where I work as a school social worker. And so I will have my 30 years of service in the next couple of years. And so I'm beginning to plan now for that transition. And I'm not sure what I want to do, if I'm going to stay in the field of social work or sell real estate, or, you know, I don't know, because I will be getting a check. So it'll be less than what I'm making now, obviously. But so in terms of the insights that I have, what I think, at least part of what I'm looking at, is I want a greater sense of community where I go. I would like to, in terms of living conditions, be in a warmer climate, I think.
Nice.
So I'm just kind of looking at the benefits to my health. I wasn't sure really how to answer identity. Wasn't quite sure how, you know, I'm in my 50s. I would think I have my identity issues all settled. But so I don't know, you might want to comment a little bit about what you might mean about that. The only issue that will be an adjustment for me is I have two adopted sons that are adults, and one is 20 and one is 26. And so they may not be very close by. So that will be an adjustment for me because we're very close. So, but I am still moving forward with my transition because they're going to be living their lives, and Pops is not going to be in, you know, the central feature of their life. So I need to do what's right for me. So I don't know if that's what you were looking for, but those are the kinds of things that I'm kind of contemplating and haven't figured it all out yet, to be honest.
Excellent. Yeah, Michael, that's great. And I really appreciate you chiming in and sharing your perspective. And, you know, the value here, I think, is you can start then to weigh some of the costs and benefits because you get it mapped out. You know, it might cost you proximity to your sons, but it might allow you to engage in the community in a different way. You know, so it's all of those things. And I'm glad you brought up this idea of identity. Some of us have a stronger identity to maybe a certain career or title than other people. So, you know, identity might not be an issue for everyone. Where I see it come into play often is when people have been very successful at something. You know, maybe they've achieved a certain title. Maybe they've so identified with their line of work where if they say, okay, if I'm not a legal counsel for this corporation, who am I? How do I add value? You know, Michael, it sounds like you have a great sense of how you add value in a lot of areas of your life. So your identity might not be as tied up in one thing. But for other people, you know, if their work is such a way of life, it can be, you know, something that can be hard. Or maybe they're eager to say, I no longer want that as my identity. I want a new identity. So that's kind of what we're going at with that part. So thank you. I'm going to read a couple of the chats. I'm struggling with whether making a change would be good for my career and personal growth or will have too many other negative implications to make it worth it. Excellent question. And what I would offer up with them with that question is as you are processing it, rather than thinking in terms of pros and cons about the options, I invite you to think about what are the costs and what are the benefits. That helps us get out of an intellectual mindset of analyzing something and helps us kind of get deeper down into how we feel and how we might viscerally respond. And then you can start to weigh out, you know, how those benefits would be impacting you deep down inside, how things might be costing you deep down inside, even if they look good or bad on paper. Let's see. I'm saying I can definitely identify with what Maureen said. What if I make this transition and am no longer an achiever? Yes. You know, if we're very driven and ambitious and then we get to a point and we see our ambitions changing and that, you know, achievement isn't the be all end all, but maybe we're looking for a place of connection and work that can give us a connection or something like that. It's hard. You know, we've probably earned our stripes as being an achiever. And then to say, oh, if that's not who I am, what am I? Excellent. Let's see. I'll look for a couple more comments here. I feel like a lot of the impacts are dependent on whether I'm going in the right direction. sorry, my thing is scrolling funny and it's hard to read it. I hope that I can find something with less working hours that would allow me to have more time for family and friends. Great. Negative impacts would be on finances potentially and starting over with a new career. What I love about this, though, is you have clarity around what you do want to be doing. You know, so it can be this balance of I'm saying no to this, but I might be saying yes to this. And if that yes has heavy weight to it, you know, and it sounds like that human connection is really important in this example, important to really be mindful of that and have that in your criteria for your decision making. Well, I'll move on from this, but I think this is a great tool for you to just kind of get the issues on the table, and then you can start seeing how they might impact what you're looking at, why you're looking at it, and how you might go about it. It all fundamentally comes down to this capacity for choice. And choice is really the tool we have that makes us human. Viktor Frankl, the author of the book Man's Search for Meaning, he talks about choice. He was an Austrian psychiatrist, a survivor of the Holocaust, and he was the first person that put out that idea of we have a stimulus and a response, but in between we have the capacity for choice. And so if we can experience something, make a choice, and that can inform our response, it elevates what we're able to do as human beings. And he used, you know, the most dramatic example possible of Holocaust survivors. And he said, during that time when he was in that situation, he learned that the only thing he truly owned in the whole wide world was his attitude. He said everything else could be taken away from him, but nobody could change the perspective he chose to have in the situation. And he said having the awareness that he had that choice in that critical life or death time really made all the difference in terms of his survival. So this capacity for choice, and I know all that is really dramatic, but it plays into what we face when we are working to create our next chapter. President Carter has a museum in Atlanta, and I was going through it a couple of years ago, and I was so taken by how many references he made throughout the museum to choice. It was in his artifacts and in his speeches, and where I really noticed it was in his speech when he won the Nobel Peace Prize. And he wrote about our capacity for choice, not in terms of do we prefer X over Y or A over B? But he talked about choice as a call to action. As a call to action to say, what do we want to focus on? What conflicts do we want to resolve? What opportunities do we want to pursue? What turmoil do we want to navigate through? And this idea of where we place our attention, the behaviors we engage in, and the choices we make inform the outcomes that we are driven towards. And I think that applies so readily to us during career transition or life transition. Where do we want to place our attention? What behaviors do we want to commit to? What choices are we willing to make? And that can become a guidepost for us as we're navigating and figuring out what it is we want to do next. Part of it involves being conscious of what you want to shed during a time. How do you let go of what's important so that you can create a space for the new? I know when I went through a major career transition about 7 years ago, I was at a crossroads. My kids were going to college. I was leaving a job I had been at for 12 years. I was contemplating launching my own business. I was moving from my home. So many different changes were going on. And I was vacationing down in Florida and walking around this little island off the coast of Florida. And in a 45-minute walk, I stepped over 6 snake skins. And if you know anything about snakes, they shed their skin as they grow. Their skin is not elastic. It does not grow with them. So in order for them to grow and lengthen and evolve, they have to shed their skin. But what's interesting, as they shed their skin, the skin pulls parasites that have clung to the snake and sheds the parasites with it. It's a great metaphor for us to say, as we're growing, what do we need to shed and what parasites might we be able to rid ourselves of in the process? You know, those might look like certain mindsets we have, limiting beliefs about what's possible. It might be ways we entangle in relationships. It might be patterns we have of working for bosses who don't maybe honor what we bring to the table, or ways that we diminish ourselves. I mean, it can be a variety of those kind of things. So I invite you to think about, what is it you would like to shed in this transition? Take 30 seconds and just write down a couple things that you would like to shed as you move into your next chapter. And I won't have us put those up in the chat room, but I just wanted to engage you in that thought process. This idea of shedding is interesting too, because we talk about watershed moments, those pinnacle experiences where everything changes. And, you know, often those involve a shedding of something as well. So a helpful question to reflect on are, what are those watershed moments that have put you on this path and will be informing your transition? So we're going to do one more exercise today before we, you know, wrap things up and move to Q&A. And this is an activity I do with clients and with people in classes around deciding what to leave behind and what to carry forward. So you can use this with the lens of a career. You might use this with the lens of a geographical transition, a relationship transition, you know, however you want to view it. But what I would like you to do is take a couple minutes and say, what do you love about this time in your life, this chapter? What are those things that, you know, inspire you, fire you up, that you really love? And you'll jot those down. Then you'll take a few minutes and think, what are the things you loathe? The things you want to say, never again, don't want to do that, never want to do a spreadsheet again, or, you know, whatever it may be. Then you're going to go down to the bottom quadrant and ask yourself, what is it you want to learn? We want to make sure, much like when you would buy shoes when you were a child and you had room for growth, you want to make sure as you move into your next step that there's room for growth. Why? We know from the neuroscience, when we're learning, when we're growing, we get dopamine hits in our brain, we get inspired, we get engaged. So you want to make sure you have an opportunity to learn and grow in your next career or life chapter. And then a moment to reflect on, what are you going to leverage? What are those things that are unique about you or your experiences that you can take to market and you can leverage? So I'm going to give you about 3 minutes on the clock to do a quick brainstorm, what you love, what you loathe, what you want to learn, and what you want to leverage. I'll mute myself and I'll call us back in 3 minutes. Okay, I'll call us back again, knowing that you could probably spend a half an hour really diving into this, but wanted to offer up an introductory tool for you. What surprised you? What area was easy, hard? So I have a question in the chat. Please explain leverage again. Excellent. So that is what you want to take forward that you think can set you apart, can open doors for you. Somebody wrote in the comments, I was just reading them while you were doing this exercise, about experiences being the resourceful one, the problem solver on your job. You know, if that's something you want to continue to do and tap into, that's, you know, your problem solving ability could be something you can leverage. Some people have a great capacity to have a long-term vision. They're very strategic. That could be something they want to leverage. Perhaps you're great at making deep relationships work, deep bonds in the workplace. You have high impact with your interpersonal savvy. Maybe that's something you want to leverage. But what are those things that you're good at, you want to bring forward, you'd like to include in your work, and that you think bring value? You know, we often talk about what are our strengths, and I like to have people think about what do they do naturally and organically in every area of their life. That's their strengths in action. That's often how they add value to the world. And sometimes we think, I operate that way with my family, but I never think about that as a career asset. Maybe it could be a career asset. So we can put that in that leverage capacity. So somebody said learn was the hardest category. I feel like I've been so consumed by my current job that I haven't had time to really think about this. Kat, that is very true, I think, for a lot of us, especially during this period of disruption when everybody's just trying to survive and we're forgetting how do we feed ourselves? How do we stay inspired? Learning is one of the key ways. You're probably not the only one that thought that was a hard section. So let's move on and talk about this idea of what inspires you, because it ties in very well with this idea of what do we want to learn. As you're going through transition, I invite you to connect deeply with what inspires you. And this doesn't have to be on a grand level. The neuroscience and research is showing when we notice things, when we take small appreciation of things that are around us, we get an energy lift. We get a sense of inspiration. So being mindful of things that give you that little lift throughout your day. You know, maybe it's listening to Yo-Yo Ma play the Bach cello suites. Maybe it's taking a walk around the block and looking at some of the trees. Maybe it's reading a favorite poem from a book. Maybe it's cooking a nice meal, but what are those things that bring that little lift of inspiration to you? You know, the Latin word for, the Latin root of inspire is inspire, and it means to breathe life into. You know, transition is tricky because for some of us, it might mean, you know, simply finding a new job, but for some of us, it is that deeper level assessment of who are we? Who do we want to be? How do we want to show up in the world? And it can be, you know, a challenging, a bit frightening time. It takes energy to move forward and move through it. And the inspiration can be a great tool to just help you keep that energy alive. So I'm going to open up for questions in just a minute. Just a real quick description of the program we have coming up with Tulane University in April. It is a program for women, and the curriculum is the same whether you're a man or a woman, but we bring in a lot of research that is unique to women's career and life transition. So that's why it's set up that way. But there are 6 live webinars. The first 2, we take time retreating, looking at what we want to take from the past and move forward, looking at how we show up in the world, how we use our language and vocabulary to talk about transition, how we kind of access that inner power to make the big leaps. The 2 middle webinars are around reinvention. How do we think broadly and start to create new possible identities for ourselves, and then how to hone in on those and see which ones really align. That's where we gain some clarity, and then we start talking about some goal setting based on those big visions. And then the last two modules are based on, you know, how do you build a network of support? How do you harness the energy to sustain yourself during a time of transition? How do you position yourself through LinkedIn and resumes? And it's a little bit more tactical that way. There's opportunities to do exercises like this and submit exercises for some personalized feedback. You also get an electronic resource book with exercises and a bibliography. And it's going to be tailored for a community of Tulane University alumni, along with University of Colorado alums. So enough about that. If you have questions, feel free to email me at info@retreatreinventrecharge.com. And now, Nicole, I'll turn it over to you to see what questions we might have. And I think I'll stop sharing right now so that I have a better glimpse of people.
Sorry, I was muted. All right, we'll start with, we do have one question in the chat on how do you gain insight on career paths and work roles when transitioning to a totally new area? And how do you gain an understanding of what's out there and what the jobs might really be like?
Excellent. So this is where that broad network really comes into play. And what I would suggest first is, as you start to think about what might even be out there, start to check in with your curiosity. What are you curious about? The rhythm of the day, the impact of the work, the pathway that led people into this field, what excites them, what drives them, what burns them out. You know, come up with this host of questions based on your curiosity. Then, if you can find a connection to anyone that works within these industries, people usually love to share what they do in their work. And if somebody can make a connection for you, or you can even reach out, you know, through social media and say, would it be possible for me to have 15 minutes to learn more about your career pathway? That you're not coming to them for a job. You're coming to them from this place of curiosity to learn more. Then you can start to chart patterns, and you can say, gosh, I'm seeing these things that are really important to me show up in these three different fields, but I'm seeing something else show up in this field. You can start to create a matrix then, and that will help you guide your decision-making process. But that network, it's so important to start to fuel a discovery process.
And Maureen, if you don't mind, I'm going to jump in. I'm going to add, we have a resource that can help people with that question. I just want to add to that, that I'll put in the chat box. It's called the Vault Online Guides, that help you get an idea about what different career paths are like, in addition to all the things Maureen says.
Awesome.
But I'll put that in the box in just a second. And Maureen, we do have a next question. Oh, someone actually asking for your contact information.
Oh, great. You know, do you mind putting Maureen at retreatreinventrecharge.com in the chat?
Sure. I mean, no, I don't. I'll say Maureen at, whoops.
And it's a bit of a mouthful, but it's retreatreinventrecharge.com. And I'd be happy to jump in a conversation with any of you, so.
Make sure I spelled it right. There we go.
Perfect. Thank you.
Sure. Let's see. Someone's asking how you sign up for that webinar series. You can do that for the course. That is on our, I'm going to make sure it's on our professional development, on our events website. We also have it on Tulane Connect. We have the link there as well. Sometimes it takes a while to get on our website because it starts till April 7th. I'm looking on there now to see if it's there, and if so, I'll put that in the chat box as well.
Great. And if you ever have a hard time finding it, you can email me, and I have the Tulane registration link that I can send as well. So.
Nicole, I'm going to drop the vault link.
Thanks. My computer's moving very slow for some reason right now.
I know, and while you're doing that, I'll address a question I often get from people who say, I want a career transition, but now is not, doesn't seem like a good time. I'm not getting all lights green to go at this point. What do I do? And that can be a really challenging situation. You know, when it's almost like you want that apple to ripen on the vine. It's like, I want to pick that apple and have that new opportunity, and it's not ready. The time isn't ready. If you can step back and say, how can I influence the role I am in right now and see if there's any room to reposition within your organization, to restructure your current role, that can be helpful. If that's not possible, another thing you can do is start looking at where are areas you can be moving the needle forward in your life if it's not simply within your career. What other classes can you take? What connections? How can you invest in building your network? What are some other ways where you feel like you can use that energy that's compelling you to make the change when you're in a situation and you can't leave your job for a variety of reasons at that moment?
Okay, thank you. And we do have another question of using LinkedIn as a tool during a transition.
So LinkedIn is a powerful tool, and I think there are a lot of ways you can leverage it. My one suggestion is taking time to make sure you have clarity of what you want to be doing before you start thinking of updating your resume and doing LinkedIn. I know when I review resumes for people, if it isn't pretty focused where they want to go, I end up kind of getting pulled all over, and I hear employers talk about that as well. So being focused, you know, doesn't have to be exact, I'm only going to do this thing, but pulling on those keywords, those key values that you want to be living through your profession and having those. The thing LinkedIn provides is an opportunity to put your future self out there. In that description right below your name, where you can talk about, you know, who you are and what you do, that is a place where you can start to write about your future self, you know, and those are the things that you want to be doing. Put those in there. And then LinkedIn is a little different than a resume. Avoid simply putting job descriptions in there. Talk about accomplishments instead, things that you were able to achieve, the impact you were able to have, the strengths you were able to leverage in current roles. That is a great place for LinkedIn. And then last of all, LinkedIn is a great tool for making that broad, vast network connection. So it might take a little mining, but if you can find, okay, I know John from over here and John is connected to this person, I can reach out to John and say, can you make an informal LinkedIn connection? I often suggest that you write out a simple email that they can adapt. Again, though, asking these connections from this place of curiosity, not with an agenda of somebody to get you a job, but to say, I'd love to learn more about your path. And I find people are usually pretty gracious and will give 10 minutes. And then it just takes discipline on your side to keep it 10 minutes, to write that formal thank you note, to nurture that connection. So excellent. Thank you, Nicole.
Yes, and so true. That's so true. We have someone asking about gaps in the resume and how for a long time that was kind of looked down upon and people had to really explain them. Can you comment on whether that's still the case, or is there more understanding about career gaps now than there used to be?
You know, I think it's a mixed bag, and I think how you present it makes all the difference. If you can talk, you know, chances are if there's a gap in a resume, you'll be asked about it. And if you can talk about it from a perspective of what you gained from that gap, it can be a powerful asset. So I know a woman who had taken years off to raise her child. One of her children had some health issues. She became a health advocate. It was a really difficult time, but when she was asked about it, she said, this is what I gleaned from that time in my life. I'm resilient. I'm very resourceful. I was able to do X, Y, and Z during this time. And I feel that that's going to make me a very valuable player on this team because I know how to navigate some of these tricky waters. I mean, I think she was going into a policy role or something. So knowing what your story is with those gaps and being clear about the narrative you have around those can be very powerful. I even know some people now that are doing resumes that aren't chronologically ordered, but they're ordered in terms of a narrative they want to tell. So I think the world is opening up to that, but I would spend time crafting your story around the gaps and not looking to hide them, but seeking the relevance in them is very powerful.
That's great. Well, thank you so much. We're just about to the end of the hour. So if we have any, we could probably take one last question. If someone wanted to submit that, you could do that now. Otherwise, I guess, hold on.
What
impact has the COVID pandemic had on transitioning to a new job? How to deal with jobs that are totally in person versus remote? That's a big question.
It's a huge question. McKinsey and Company did some pretty deep research around this with the lens of women's careers. So the gentleman on the website or on our webinar, I'm sorry, I don't have complimentary information, but for women, they found that the burnout rate skyrocketed. They at first in 2020, they said 1 in 4 women were stepping back from their careers. By 2021, it was 1 in 3 women. It's had a huge impact. And working from home has been a positive solution for some, but for others, it's been an absolute nightmare, right? So I think what it's done in terms of career transition has exposed a lot of unknowns, and we don't have the answers to it yet. Everybody's coming to the table with different wants, different needs. I don't think employers know how to respond. I do know that from their perspective, as they've had a vast, you know, number of resignations, they're frantically trying to fill jobs. They're finding their hiring practices are less than perfect. So they're not building relationships with people who are applying for jobs. Instead, you know, they're letting people fall through the cracks in some instances. That hurts them. It hurts us as job seekers too. So it's, I think it's a difficult time. I think COVID has exposed a lot of pain points, and I think it is requiring us to offer up a lot of grace for ourselves and for hiring managers that, you know, people are trying to navigate through this, but it is uncharted territory for sure.
That is so true. We'll end on that note, I think. So again, just want to thank everyone so much for coming, for joining us today. You may definitely want to look back on some of these exercises that Maureen presented. And so we'll have the video posted on YouTube by the end of the day. You can find that, you'll be able to find that on our professional development page. Thank you much. And I put, we had the link in the chat for registering, but if you still want that, please feel free. You can register, you can email myself or Sarah, or our main line alumni career subtealing edu. So thank you so much. And
Nicole, could I say one other thing?
Yep.
I forgot to mention, we have on our website a white paper that has to do with women and confidence and some of the research around that. And another one about women in negotiation, kind of busting the myth that women are poor negotiators. There's a lot of compelling research out there. So those are free resources. I think you might just have to plug into the website. And if you have any problems, email me. I'll get you those. So thank you.
Thanks, Maureen. And yes, we'll try to get that link out to everybody. I see a couple of people requested it. Thanks so
awesome.
Much. Enjoy the rest of your day. And
thank
we hope
you.
To see you
too.
Again on another one of our professional development series sessions. Thanks.
Awesome. Thanks for having me. Bye-bye.